55 Jacksonville.
I feel like I can do it all. You know, I did so much when I was at Buffalo, whether if it was, you know, catching deep balls or, you know, lead blocking through the C gap. I mean, I feel like I'm very versatile and can, you know, play any type of game that needs to be played whichever week.
Here's Allen, taken to the right, going to the end zone. And who else? Gabe Davis with the touchdown catch on the opening drive.
You know, I think it's going to go very well. And, you know, I plan to have a long career. You know, I think I got a good 5 or 6 more years in me. So I don't plan on stopping anytime soon.
I done did it before, going to teams that didn't really have it all the way together. Then, like, early years, a new head coach and stuff. And you got to deal with just that early year. But, like, I know this team, you know, is moving forward, moving up.
1010 XL 92.5 FM presents Jaguars Today with your hosts Mike Dempsey, Tony Smith, and Dylan Denmark.
All right, moving forward, moving on up, getting better every single day. That's what we strive for. Jaguars Today, just like your Jacksonville Jaguars. Good morning, everybody. Happy Monday to you as we get to the final week of March. Tony, good morning. How are you?
Doing well.
How's your bracket looking?
I don't know.
No?
I didn't check basically the back half of yesterday's results against my bracket.
How were you doing before
that? I was doing all right.
Good,
I had Baylor in the Final Four, so that's done.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't feel like I was ever in a position to win.
Yeah.
You know, the whole thing, but I felt like I was doing all right through the first 3 days of the tournament, but I don't know how the back half of it went.
I was doing great up until yesterday, despite the fact that I lost Kentucky, who I had in the Final Four. Like, outside of that one pick, I was doing fantastic right up until Texas A&M couldn't beat Houston in overtime. I mean, when he hit that shot, though, I don't know if you were watching when that shot went down. That was the shot of the tournament so far. 1.2 seconds left, great inbounds pass, and dude knocks down that three. And sometimes, you know, the team that gets stunned like that takes that punch and they don't recover. But it was like Texas A&M never recovered. Houston dominated them. Anyway, it was fun while it lasted. I got 12 in the Sweet 16, but I feel like everyone's got a dozen in the Sweet 16 this year. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't know how many I wound
up
having, but it's going to be around 11 or 12.
Something like that.
And the only Elite Eight or beyond that I lost was Baylor.
Yeah, I think that might be the only one I did, too.
Yeah, was Kentucky.
Baylor. It's Kentucky, yeah, going on. Anyway, Pockets is down to 9 teams somehow in the Sweet 16.
9 out of 16, baby.
But he was out in the sunshine playing golf this weekend. Pockets, it was a great day yesterday to be downwind. Let's just put it that way.
Yes, and then bad day for headwind.
I got to say, the St. John's County course, however it was set up, I got a few crosswinds. I only got one right in my face, so I'm very appreciative of the layout and the prevailing winds yesterday. All right, so today, Doug Peterson and many of the crew are down with the owners' meetings going on in Orlando, and Mike DiRocco is down there from ESPN. D-Rock will join us about an hour from now, as a matter of fact, to get the word on what Peterson had to say. You'll hear what Doug Peterson had to say. We'll play you that audio throughout, Tony. I think one of the things that came out this morning that is interesting is the confirmation, I guess, of how they envision the secondary playing out right now. Couple times was asked about Darnell Savage, mentioned him playing nickel. And then when they got into the cornerback room, he specifically said, yeah, we added Ronald Darby to play opposite Tyson, and we've got Savage, who is the nickel, right? Or words to that effect.
Yeah.
And so it's pretty clear because I wondered at the time when they signed him, okay, 3-year deal, decent money. Is he one of your safeties? And I feel like the safeties are almost interchangeable, right? Mm-hmm. Strong versus free, whatever you want to describe it. And would Antonio Johnson, who'd played some of that big nickel.
Yeah, who's playing where?
Right,
yeah.
Would he be that guy? And it seems like Johnson will be a full-time safety here, which means he'll be on the field basically all the time, which is great. I mean, he's a rising, what we hope is a young, I don't want to necessarily say future star, but a rising, intriguing player on this roster, of which I wish we had a few more.
Yeah, that at least sounds like that's where it's going to start, right? And we'll see what happens with the way everyone plays and who fits what position better, you know, as they get into it. But that is at least what it sounds like the plan is as they go into this offseason, is Antonio is going to be the strong safety and Savage is going to be the nickel corner. And they may get 3 weeks into that and say, actually, we need to switch that.
Maybe so. Right?
Like, the team may be better with this guy playing there and that guy playing there. Like, they may decide that, but at least going into it, that's what they've announced as their plan.
I think they evaluated Savage to play that spot. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I don't think they signed him and went, oh, you know what? Here's an idea. You know what I mean? So I do think they looked at it, and he got a 3-year, like, $21 million deal with about $12 million guaranteed, so, which is probably really a 2-year deal. But I think now you do feel a little bit more solid if you look at it like that, because Ronald Darby's played a lot of good football, mm-hmm. again, when he has stayed healthy. Nobody's saying that corner isn't one of their top needs. It definitely is a big need. But you could play right now. You could start a game with what you have on the roster
yes.
right now. And
assuming they get through camp healthy.
Obviously, yes. right. At this moment, presuming we fast forward to the season, everyone's healthy, you could play with what you have. Yeah. Now, do you need
one
more
injury
depth?
Happens yes. somewhere right now. You're looking at Monteric Brown or Christian Braswell
absolutely.
Going into the lineup.
But you could, one injury at a lot of spots, right? One injury
absolutely.
At running back. And what exactly, how confident do we feel in Dearness Johnson and or Tank Bigsby to lead this team for a month out of the backfield, right? So I think you could do that with a number of spots. But, anyway, it'll be good to hear. Oh, I always appreciate hearing from Doug Peterson. And, we're a little bit removed from the emotion of the season now. So, we'll hear what he feels about a lot of these veteran additions that they signed during free agency and where things stand heading into the NFL draft. But got thinking about it today, Tony, and our question of the day we've done a lot of, okay, what do they still need to focus on, mm-hmm. right? What do they got to do with the 17th pick in the draft? What do they have to do here? Where do they have to get better? Who would you like to see them trade for? What about the other side of it? Where do you feel like they're pretty good right now, right? With the majority of free agency being done, we don't know. There could always be another signing. We saw Travis Gibson and Joey Sly a week ago today into that second week of free agency. So you still might get a veteran like that. Mm-hmm. along the way, but we're asking you today, with the major moves likely done, what do you think is currently the strongest position group on the Jaguars? And I didn't make this in poll form because I didn't want to limit it, right? I think this is kind of wide open, and the one I'm thinking of, I don't even know if it's really, I guess it's been mentioned a little bit, but a lot of people going with quarterback, which I totally understand.
Yeah,
because you feel like it's unquestionably the most important position group on this team. I would argue that right now it's not the best position group on this team, but that's a good debate to have, and we can discuss that throughout the course of the day today. Is this a difficult question for you, or you, without giving it away, does something jump out to you on this football team?
Nothing jumped out.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, I'm still going through it in my head, which direction I'd even want to go with it.
How many position groups would you say you feel pretty good about right now as you go through this process? I feel good about safety. You know what I mean? I don't think it's necessarily – that doesn't mean it's the best position group, but I don't think you need to add anything to that position group.
No.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
With Wingert and Daniel Thomas, in addition to the three frontline guys, I think you're set there, for instance.
Yeah, I think – there's a couple of groups like that, but I don't think there's even all that many of that. Like, safety, yeah, I feel good about safety. I feel good about what they have at inside linebacker.
Sure.
Certainly. They've overinvested in that spot, and it shows up when you're talking about something like today, but there's not a bunch of those spots for me on the team.
Well,
running back,
maybe.
The
quarterback room now is with Mac Jones in there, and I don't know. Listen to Doug this morning. We'll hear some of the comments. He's talking about that quarterback room with Doug and C.J. Beathard and Mac Jones. It's like, are you really going to carry three quarterbacks this year? For now, sure.
Yeah.
And throughout the offseason, whatever, because injuries happen. But
and your roster's 90.
September, whatever. Yeah. First game of the year. Are we going to really have three quarterbacks on the 53-man roster?
Considering what they did with their third quarterback last year, if they kept all three of these, I would be stunned.
Stunned, right? I really...
Like, Rourke at least was a guy that you could see develop into something long-term. Like, none of these guys, like, they're either your backup quarterback this year or they can try to be a backup somewhere else.
C.J. Beathard feels like a kind of guy that if you cut him and he signs somewhere else, you're like, eh, all right. And if he doesn't, you're like, okay, well... hey, CJ, if we get an injury,
right,
we're calling you,
yeah,
right? And you're first man up, and you come right back on the active roster.
I'm not all that upset. I never was upset that Nathan Rourke got nabbed off the squad, right? Like, that never bothered me all that much. you know. But at least that's a guy that you could see developing into something, you know, in the long term as a backup quarterback maybe in the league. Okay, like that guy's interesting from that perspective. I think we've seen whatever C.J. Beathard's going to be. And to some degree, we've seen whatever Mac Jones is going to be. I would expect Mac Jones to be the guy that they land on as the backup quarterback for this year.
I would be stunned if he's not.
Right? But I'm not going to be all that upset about either one of those guys getting cut whenever that happens. Okay.
No, I'm with you. I'm with you on that one. And look, if Nathan Rourke doesn't make the spinning pirouette, you know, escape.
Unbelievable
play. It was a great play, right? Without that one single play, does anyone care that Nathan Rourke got scooped up? Not many.
Probably not.
No. I don't think that many of them would be that worked up about it. We got a 4-round mock draft from Chad Ryder over at NFL.com. See if he hits the high points. I thought some curious picks for the Jags. Not some, you know, the positions I thought he did well with. I didn't love all the players. So we'll get into that a little bit later on if we have time to dig into it today. And we will accept your feedback if you would like to give it at 641-1010 on the All-Pro Roofing phone lines or on the text line designed by Lifetime Enclosures. Again, the question of the day: with the major moves in free agency likely done for the Jags, what do you think is currently the strongest position group on the Jaguars? You can hit us up on the phone lines, the text line, or on social media at MD_1010XL, at 1010XL Fat Tony, and at 1010XL Denmark.
Ain't no laws when you're drinking claws, baby.
Wasn't sure which way he was going to start off the week. But there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. All right, we're ready to roll. D-Rock under an hour away, but we'll come back and we'll let you hear from your head coach, Doug Peterson, speaking at the NFL owners' meetings earlier this morning. Let's get into it. A fresh week of Jaguar football right here on Jaguars Today on 1010XL and 92.5 FM.
Jaguars Today.
Jaguars Today.
From the JOI Studios at 1010XL.
Jacksonville Orthopedic Institute.
Where the pros go. Joe C.
We all know this man, and he drinks beer.
Matt Hayes.
Someone's had my driver's license suspended.
Mia O'Brien.
American women are seldom so straightforward.
And Leon Searcy.
But she's a tight.
XL Prime Time. Noon to 3 on 1010XL.
Hard Rock Bet presents Legal in Florida.
You can bet the game on Hard Rock Bet.
Get a no-regret first bet up to $100 when you sign up now. Offered by the Seminole Tribe of Florida. Must be 21 and over and physically present in Florida to wager. Terms and conditions apply. Concerned about gambling? Please call 1-888-ADMITTED.
It's March basketball. That means a host of top teams will be competing for the NCAA title. When it comes to commercial painters, there's also some healthy competition out there. Jason Parker with Performance Painting. To help you know the right questions to ask any painter competing for your business this year, visit PerformancePaintingJax.com. Or if you're ready for a friendly quote, give us a call and ask about our free pressure wash promotion for your next project. Performance Painting, quality coatings applied with pride.
Performance Painting!
Now that's what I call high quality H2O.
If you want high-quality water throughout your home, call your local Water Boy. We install equipment to solve any water problem. WaterBoyJAX.com.
Did you know Prime Roofing manufactures, fabricates, and installs their metal roofs? If you're thinking about a metal roof, think Prime Roofing. Schedule an estimate today at PrimeRoofingFL.com. That's PrimeRoofingFL.com.
Add an ace to your Tuesday morning.
The third ace in 4 days.
Brunch with a Tour.
Tour news, tips, and inside info.
Brought to you by Clearwater Irrigation and Art of Natural Stone.
8:30 Tuesday morning on 1010XL.
We don't have too many cold nights on the First Coast, but when the temperature drops, you want to hit the heat button and warm up. That's where Florida Home comes in. They're the AC experts in Jacksonville, and the importance of keeping your heating system in good working order is really important. If it stops working when it gets cooler, Florida Home will leap into action and provide you with the best solution. Heater and heat pump repair service and new system installation. They do it all. Just call Florida Home AC at 777-4300, the official heating and AC partner of the Jaguars.
Remember that the Big Diamond Store doesn't want you to shop and compare. They know they can't beat Beard's Diamonds prices.
Right now, it's 0% financing for 5 years, plus get zero down on everything in the store.
Don't buy anywhere until you shop Beard's Diamonds.
Hey there, Jacksonville. With scorching temperatures just around the corner, it's crucial to ensure your AC is blowing nice and cool. Duck Duck Air Conditioning is here to keep you comfortable all summer long. But don't wait until the heat gets here. Our service techs are ready right now to handle any cooling issues you may have at your home or business. Call Duck Duck AC today at 904-862-6769 to schedule. That's 904-862-6769. Duck Duck Air Conditioning. Online at duckduckac.com.
Pickin' here. You know at Zero Res, they love rugs. Fine oil rugs need to be cleaned with the right equipment and careful training. My guy at Zero Res, Gerard, is a certified master rug cleaner and has been cleaning rugs for more than 5 years. Don't trust your fine rugs to anyone. Call Zero Res right now. They are offering a BOGO on rug cleaning. Have Zero Res clean one rug, get a second rug for free. What a great time to get your rugs cleaned. Zero Res, man. Spell it forward, spell it backwards. Zero Res. It's the right way to clean.
Zero Res.
Leon Sersa here, Jaguar legend and three-time national champion. Are you ready to elevate your game and dominate on the gridiron? Our elite offensive line camp is designed for young athletes who aspire to push their limits, refine their skills, and become the very best. It's called the Lineman Life. Sunday, April 14th, D1 training on Beach Boulevard. Whether you are aiming to make a starting lineup or a college scholarship, this camp is for you. Spots are limited, so secure your spot now. Go to eventbrite.com, the Lineman Life, dash, offensive line camp. Enter promo code 1010 and get $25 off. Greatness awaits.
Are you suffering from shoulder pain? If you have clicking and popping in the shoulder joint, persistent pain that intensifies with use, an inability to lift your arm over your head, or a tingling, burning sensation in the shoulder, elbow, or wrist, waiting to see a doctor could make your injury worse. Baptist Health and Jacksonville Orthopedic Institute have innovative and effective treatment options available right now to relieve your pain and restore your mobility. Don't wait. Call 904-JOI-2000.
The time to buy an emergency generator is before you need it, not when you're sitting in the dark. Storms happen in a hurry in Florida, so be prepared. Protect your family and property with American Electrical Contracting. Call them today, 737-7770.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. Now more Jaguars today on 1010XL.
Pockets, how many crab legs you take down this weekend?
I think it was like 25, something like that.
25? Are these like big?
It was a variety. I tried to get the big ones. There was probably like five or six ones.
But what are we talking about? Like when we're talking about crab legs, we're not talking about these little swimmers, man. We're talking about
these
the
were big
like king crab legs.
Yeah.
25 of them I could polish off. I think it's honestly, part of eating crabs is the whole process. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
It's like a ritual of, you know, the cracking of the crabs. It's
you
got
to put
deal.
In work to eat crabs.
When I was a kid, it was like the treat of treats. You know, we'd get live blue crabs, and we'd get newspaper out and cover the table, and we'd go to town, man. And that was like the greatest thing in the world. I could eat a lot of crab meat now.
It's funny. I've never eaten crab. Well, I think I did once when I was like 10.
Yeah?
Then I've eaten like twice in the last month.
And you're saying you like, before the last month you've eaten no crab than one time?
Nah.
And you love it, right?
I love it now.
Again, yeah.
Why? Oh, okay. Yeah. Why would you deny yourself, man? You know? Kidding me? Anything seafood's good, my book. All right.
I'm with you there.
Live in a pretty good place for all that good stuff. I would like to try to top the 25 king crab legs that Pockets claims he took down. I think I could do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I don't know if Awaken 180 would be on board with that, but I think I could do it. I'm just saying, mentally. I'm there. All right. Let's get into it's nothing at all to do. There's no segue here to Doug Peterson, who spoke this morning.
He probably loves crab as much as we all do.
Why wouldn't he?
Yeah.
I mean, it's phenomenal,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely,
little butter, whatever. Or just eat it that way, man. Yeah. You know, eat it plain. It's delicious. It's crab. Are you kidding me? Doug Peterson speaking this morning. D-Rock was in attendance. Mike will join us coming up in about 40 minutes to get his on-the-scene perspective sometimes, you know. But you can – it's the video's out there for you if you want to watch Dougie P. But if you're driving around Jacksonville right now listening to Jaguars today, A, we appreciate you listening. And B, we're here to be that conduit so you don't have to worry about trying to watch your phone as you're behind the wheel. traveling around I-95 right now. So let's get into it. Here's Doug Peterson, just giving some overall thoughts before he gets into specifics on this year's free agency class.
I mean, you would hope so, right? I mean, obviously, we haven't played a game yet, so we don't really know. But I feel like we've added some pieces through free agency that are going to help us. They give us depth. You know, we got some experienced guys in like Eric Armstead, Mitch Morse, who can really add some, one, the competition you're looking for, but two, I think a veteran presence at those positions. You know, a guy like Mac Jones to come in and solidify and really give us three quarterbacks that you're going to need, you know, as we've seen, as history would say. You know, our number one thing, though, is to keep Trevor healthy. Our best chance of winning games is keeping Trevor healthy. You know, so I feel like we've – and then re-signing guys, you know, like the DTs, right? Daniel Thomas and Caleb Johnson and restructuring Brandon and, you know, getting Ezra Cleveland back and just being able to kind of work through your roster that way and you know, getting the guys that are going to help us win football games moving forward.
All right, again, with the three quarterbacks, which you're going to need, you know, like, I hope not. and I get it. Bedford was banged up a little bit last year, too. So you want, you know, and we know that, and you'll hear probably Doug Peterson talk about it if we get to it this morning. But, you know, Trevor Lawrence not practicing impacted him last year, Tone. And I think if they felt like they had a better option, then maybe they would have gone to that option more so than just for the one game against Carolina with CJ Beathard. You know, maybe had Mac Jones been on this team, he would have started one or two games and given Trevor Lawrence a chance to get fully healthy where he could practice. And particularly because you had built up such a gap, you know, like you were playing for the number one seed in the AFC. So you were certainly had some wiggle room in there. They squandered it all and gave it all away. But again, you hear that, or I hear that, and it makes me wonder if their plan is to carry three throughout the season.
I hear it, and I still hear, like in my mind, I hear, well, we need three quarterbacks during camp.
Maybe. Right? And like, if that's, it's that, fine.
That's what I hear there, but we'll see how they want to deal with all that.
But Jones, obviously not a camp arm. I mean, you're going out, you trade for a guy, you're going out with an idea that he's going to have a specific role. He's going to be your backup.
And I also file that under, you know, as we talked about when the season ended, and we'll hear about Luke Fortner here in just a moment, but when the season ended and they were asked about Luke Fortner and they over and over said they're comfortable with him, right? They feel good about him going forward and all this. I was like, they'll answer that by what they do, right? And I feel like what they want to do with two, three quarterbacks will be answered by when they cut the third, right? Like, and then all of whatever that is will be gone. There's no reason to burn CJ Beathard now. Necessarily, or Mac Jones now, if you're the head coach, you just, we got three quarterbacks. We feel good about all three of these guys. We'll see what that looks like for us going into the future. But talking about Luke Fortner, coach was asked this morning about what does it look like at center now with them bringing in Mitch Morse and that competition with Luke Fortner for that job.
Well, yeah, you guys know I was in Kansas City when we drafted him, so obviously liked him. And now that he became available, you know, and Luke's, listen, this is not it's not a knock on Luke at all. It's just a matter of getting better at a position, getting better as a group. And I think Mitch brings a veteran presence. He's done it for several years now. And it's really somebody that Luke can invest some time learning from, right, and understanding. You know, I think Mitch's strengths can be Luke's weaknesses and vice versa, right? Luke's strengths, Mitch's weaknesses, and they can really work together and have what I would, you know, that competition that you want. And so having a guy like Mitch, a veteran backup, come in, much like when we signed Brandon a couple years ago, just helps us better as an offensive line.
Did he say a veteran backup?
He did. I don't know where that came from. And Mitch has no weaknesses, coach. No, okay.
And what are Luke Fortner's strengths that are the weaknesses of Mitch Morse?
I don't know.
I feel like this was,
every now and then a guy gets asked a question. It's like, well, I'll answer it.
We got a third round young guy draft. We drafted him here. He didn't choose to come here. All he's done is go out there and give us what he's had for the first 2 years. It, obviously, we needed to upgrade it.
right? I feel like he wants to say, look, we all knew, right?
We knew.
Why are you asking me this? Yeah. Like, you all were clamoring for this, yeah. right? And, yeah, we get it. We just want to hear your thoughts on yeah. it. And I think this is just an – it's obvious – competition, upgrade, however you want to describe it. Mitch Morse is brought in here to play.
Yep.
Wasn't brought in here to push Luke Fortner, in my opinion, to bring out the best in Luke Fortner.
Maybe in 2 years.
Sure.
Right.
Maybe in 2 years, or maybe you're just hitting reset on the position in its entirety at some yeah. point between now and then. Some people would still like to see them do that with the 17th pick in the draft, but nevertheless, I don't think there's in my mind, any ambiguity that Mitch Morse is here
no.
to be a guy to raise the level of play of this offensive line. And you're not going to do that from the bench, certainly. So we'll see how that all plays out. But I, you know, nothing I heard there makes me, even though he kind of referred to veteran backup there, I think you could look at Luke Fortner as being the veteran backup.
Well, he's a veteran backup.
He's a veteran now. Yeah. You know, you've been in the league for a couple of years. But it was odd, right?
The wording of it was odd.
The wording was odd.
Yeah.
The money, you don't go, by the way, you don't go pay a veteran backup center the money that Mitch Morse got, even though it was a good deal by free agency standards. Mm-hmm. Like, it was, I saw a piece today that listed it as one of the best economical free agent signings out there in terms of expected impact and what you had to pay to get him, and that he's still a really good player, and they, you know, they were going on about him and how it was a really good signing for the Jags. If you looked at him as like a guy to come push Fortner and maybe be the backup, you give him Tyler Shatley money, right? You're not giving him the money that you gave him, and he had options as well. And I don't mm-hmm. think he chose to come here to try to tutor Luke Fortner. Gabe Davis came here to play. Thought he was going to play with Calvin Ridley and Christian Kirk, but, you know, knew going in that was a possibility that it might not go down that way. But either way, wanted to come to Florida for a variety of reasons. You heard that from Gabe Davis's side. What about Doug Peterson's side? What made Gabe Davis attractive to the Jaguars?
Gabe is that to me, he's like a Swiss Army knife. You know, he can run routes. The guy's right around 81, 82 targets a year for the last 4 years, you know, if you average them out. So he's a big part of the offense, you know, in Buffalo. And I think he's going to be another key piece to what we're doing. And you know, we can put him in positions to block. We can put him in positions to run. He's a good route runner. He's strong. He's big. He's local. You know, I mean, all things are positive with Gabe. And really looking forward to getting him in there and seeing how he does fit with Christian and Zay and, you know, even Devin Duvernay now, getting him in that mix. And obviously Parker Washington, Elijah Cook, some of the young guys we have. It should be a really good, exciting offseason to see just how we can make all these pieces work.
And that guy we're going to draft at 17, I mean, or 48, or 90, is it 96? I think they have right
something
now. 96.
Yeah.
Pockets confirms it's 96. Pockets is our official repository of all draft information.
Don't ask me anything else.
No, 96. What comes after that?
97.
Thank you.
That's
Tony.
It.
I was like,
good job.
I mean, he was I stumped him. I got him right there, but he's going to go with you on that one. 81 targets for Gabe Davis last year, right? 136 for Calvin Ridley. Mm-hmm. So that's those 55 targets. I don't think Gabe Davis is getting 136 targets in this
probably
offense. So likely what you're going to have, you know, get another piece in here and see how it's all divvied up. And plus, you know, if Christian Kirk is healthy, some of those targets that went to Ridley late in the season.
Thought he would have had another 35 or something.
He would have, certainly.
You know, on that back month of the season.
Right. But either way, I'm not concerned about the number of targets. I'm more concerned. Like, I really would love to be in a position where Gabe Davis is your third receiver for this football team. I don't know if you're going to get that. Even if you draft Brian Thomas Jr. right out of the gates, is he maybe he just comes into camp and mini camps and starts tearing things up right away, Tone. But I think there's, like, A, he may not be there at 17. B, he may not be the apple of the Jag's eye. C, they may opt to go another position, mm-hmm. right? Or they may just go, hey, it's so deep at receiver, we're going to take a guy at 48 or maybe even into the third round. I saw that Chad Ryder mock had him going with Malachi Corley out of Western Kentucky with that 96 pick.
Okay.
Corley, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so again, well, we need receiver. Well, you need this, you need this, you need a lot of things.
You need a bunch.
You can't get them all with the one spot. So, look, you go back again a couple of years ago. Is Gabe Davis as good as Marvin Harrison or Marvin Jones Jr. was at that point in time? I don't think he's as good as Marvin Harrison Sr. or Jr. is going to be my guess. But you know what I mean? Like, I think Marvin Jones had more knowledge of how to play the position because he had done it for a long time in the National Football League. But I think at this stage, Gabe Davis's physical skills are more advanced than Marvin Harris or Marvin Jones. I keep wanting to say Marvin Harris, obviously.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying?
No, I do. And look, it'll be interesting to see how that all works. The veteran side of that with Marvin Jones certainly made an impact on the connection he had with Trevor.
No doubt.
Right?
No doubt.
And that developed basically from the moment he walked in. Yeah. And so is Gabe that level of veteran? You know, at this point in his career, probably not. But he is a better athlete, you know, at the wide receiver position than Marvin Jones
was
when he got here. Right. So it's trying to balance those things and where exactly do they wind up landing with all that. Do we want to get one more?
Now let's break because we got Ingram and Strange questions on the tight end room. And rather than breaking them up, let's keep them together. And look, we got plenty of time to get into all of this. Doug Peterson spoke for over half an hour this morning. So there's quite a lot of content coming out of this. We'll get to more of that on the other side, and then we'll get to Mike DiRocco coming up to lead off hour number two as D-Rock was right there sitting next to Doug Peterson during this Q&A, and we'll get his thoughts and any impressions he picked up in speaking with Doug, because what happens with a lot of this, sometimes you get the official on-camera, and then you get everything breaks up, and Doug continues to talk to folks, or coaches continue to do that for a few minutes, so we might get a little bit of extra on that front as well from D-Rock. That's coming up just under 30 minutes from now. Mike Dempsey, Tony Smith, Dylan Denmark here with you. If you want to be part of the conversation, 641-1010 is the easiest way to do it on the All-Pro Roofing phone lines or on the text line designed by Lifetime Enclosures. Your Chad and Sandy real estate question of the day. With the major moves in free agency likely done, what do you think is currently the strongest position group on the Jacksonville Jaguars? Hit us up with your reply to that, and we'll discuss as the program goes along. This is Jaguars Today on 1010XL 92.5 FM.
Jaguars Today.
From the JOI studios at 1010XL. Believe in the unbelievable.
Unbelievable!
1010XL.
I can't believe it! I can't believe it!
We're hearing is believing.
Unbelievable!
What makes a Honda certified pre-owned vehicle so special? 182-point inspection, 24/7 roadside assistance, first-year free oil changes, and a 7-year, 100,000-mile warranty for carefree driving backed by American Honda. Visit your local Honda dealer today.
Hey gang, Hicken here. March is Workplace Eye Wellness Awareness Month. Here's a tip for those in front of a computer all day. Follow the 20-20-20 rule. Set a timer as a reminder to look 20 feet away every 20 minutes for 20 seconds. This can be as simple as looking away from your computer screen or out the window. If virtual meetings keep you in your seat for extended time, shut your eyes for 20 seconds. Call or visit BowdenEye.com today to schedule your consultation. BowdenEye, keeping the First Coast focused.
Give us your hot take.
Pop quiz, hot shot.
On the 1010XL text line, designed by Lifetime Enclosures.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, I'm awake and I speak English, so yeah, I do know what you're saying.
Be part of the conversation. 641-1010.
This is Hayes Carline for First Florida Credit Union. I bank with First Florida Credit Union because I trust them. I can always count on them when it comes to the vast services they provide. First Florida Credit Union was voted Best Bank in the 2023 Best of Bold City Community Choice Awards, and it's easy to see why. I go to the branch off 210 in St. Johns County and the new Durbin location, but they have 10 branches in the Jacksonville area. You need to be banking with First Florida Credit Union. They're enriching people every day. Federally insured by NCUA, Equal Housing Opportunity Lender.
I'm with Greg from Cycles of Jacksonville. I know Honda, they're so cool on the road and off the road, but guess what? Tell them about them being on the water.
There is an all-new Honda boat coming out. Went out and partnered with Scout, who's been making the finest hulls in the business for years. They're fuel-efficient, dynamic, and class-leading.
So Honda is in the boat business, and you will see boats coming to Cycles of Jacksonville soon.
We will have them in the spring, ready to go.
CyclesofJacksonville.com. Keep track of all of it. Find them on Atlantic near Regency.
Dave Binion here with my son Ammon, who is the air duct cleaning manager at Zero Res. So Ammon, you may notice a little rattle in my voice and some puffiness in my eyes. That's because allergy season is coming on. Can Zero Res help?
Yes, your health has a lot to do with the air you breathe. A clean and healthy home begins with clean air. At Zero Res, we can help clean the air in your home by cleaning your air ducts, cleaning the coils in your HVAC units, and fogging the system with a powerful antimicrobial that helps kill and control the growth of microorganisms in your air. We also have options for maintaining your clean air with our excellent inline air purifier and UV lights that will help keep your system clean and healthy. At Zero Res, we are more than just air duct cleaners. We're clean air specialists.
Have Zero Res air duct specialists out, and right now we'll give you $50 off your air duct cleaning, and while we're at it, we'll give you $50 off your dryer vent cleaning. Zero Res,
spelled forward or backwards, it's the right way to clean.
C-E-R-O-R-E-C, Zero Res.
This is Hayes Carlion for Skylife Elite. Have you ever thought about aircraft ownership as another potential revenue stream and as a tool for tax savings? Put your tax money to work for you while enjoying the benefits of private personal travel. Skylife Elite has over a decade of experience in business aviation and can guide you through the process with their expert staff. Call my friends over at Skylife Elite at 490-9332 or find them at flyskylife.com to get the rundown on everything owning an airplane can do for you.
Hacker here, and most of us have a closet full of clothes ranging in sizes, keeping around the smaller ones for when we plan to fit into them again. If you told me just a month ago I'd already be wearing a full shirt size smaller, I'd laugh. But thanks to Awaken 180, dropping 35 pounds in just 4 weeks, this guy has already dropped a full shirt size. Notches on my belt, too. Crazy results, and I'm just getting started. The best part? I'm not on this journey alone. My Awaken 180 coach, Kate, is there whenever I need her. I've tried other programs before, but I have never received the kind of results and support I'm getting with Awaken 180. 35 pounds in 4 weeks, and I feel better than I have in years. What's stopping you? Do what Mike Dempsey, Matt Hayes, and I did. Make the call to Awaken 180, 844-346-1800. That's 844-346-1800, or online at awaken180weightloss.com.
Ackerman Cancer Center now offers total body MRI, the latest industry-leading technology. Just one non-invasive scan provides a complete picture of your health to detect and monitor cancer with precision at AckermanCancerCenter.com.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555, Jacksonville. Jaguars today on 1010XL.
All right, Jaguars today moving along here. More from the head coach, Doug Peterson, momentarily. Mike DeRocca will be along. Got a four-round mock. I don't know if we'll get to it today or not. From Chad Ryder, who's one of our favorite draft guys. Mm-hmm. Pockets, note to self or note to you or note to whatever. Chad Ryder might fill a spot tomorrow on the program.
All right, I got his number.
Just throwing that out
there. I can
reach
out to him.
You know. Did a four-round mock with five Jaguar picks in there. You forget, you got those two. It's going to be fun. 114, 116.
Reminder that our show is on Eastern time. He's in Central.
Our show is on Eastern time. Yeah. Thank you.
Because he was working. Now he's like, oh. He's like, that was another hour.
Oh, that's a reminder for Chad.
Yeah.
Not a reminder for us.
Note to self.
Note to self and others. You know, the great thing about Jaguars today, it is Eastern. If we, for the guests, it's very important. But I don't know what percentage of our audience, Tony, but it's a large one that goes back and listens on demand.
Absolutely.
You know, or watches on demand, and we love that. You know, go check us out on YouTube. Just search 1010XL or Jaguars Today, and I mean, if you want to watch us, I don't know. There's really all that much exciting. I'm wearing gray today from head to toe, which is kind of my color. Mm-hmm. I like gray. I decided gray was my favorite color when I was like 15 years old. Gray goes with everything.
It
you
does.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
What I'm saying.
Teal. I got the teal.
Teal,
on.
Of course. I know you do because you rep.
It was always the Jags.
It was always the Jags for Tony Smith, except for when it was the Giants years ago.
Years ago,
people.
It was a while ago.
We all had different things if we're old enough years ago. All right, let's get back into it with Dougie P here. Told you we'd talk about this tight end room, and he was asked about it today. D-Rock, I believe, as a matter of fact, is the one who asked him specifically about Evan Engram and Could he develop into more of a deep threat? You know, as you're wondering, who will the deep threats be on this team? I do think Gabe Davis, Tony, certainly. You look at his yards per catch average. Clearly he's a deep threat. I think Christian Kirk at times can be a deep threat for this football team as well. But where does Evan Engram fit in on that front?
Yeah, it depends on how you want to use him. But he's definitely capable of doing that. He's shown that. We've got, as a staff, we've got to put him in positions to do that, number one. And, yeah, I mean, that, you know, for a guy like Evan, I think that's, you know, with his skill set, I think it's would only help us, right? With his ability to get down the field, his speed, you know, strong to the catch point, all that kind of stuff. You know, and again, I put it more back on us as you know, play callers, decision makers, to make sure that we are, you know, putting him in that position.
This feels to me, and we'll ask D-Rock about this coming up here in about 20 minutes. This feels to me like a guy who's writing a story on the tight end room. Am I right? You know what I mean? Like reporters go in and they're like, all right, I want to write about the tight end room and where things stand, so I'm going to ask some specific questions about that, which is fine, right? That's what this is for. You can ask anything you like, whatever interests you or whatever you're working on. I told you, to me, because I didn't realize D-Rock asked the question, it sounded when I first heard this answer like a fantasy football question, right? Like you get those writers that go and that's specifically what they're looking for. And so you get that odd question about how a specific player is going to be used in that offense. And then you end up seeing the quotes don't like, well, Doug Peterson said Evan Engram can be a tremendous deep threat, as if he just stepped to the podium and said, gather around here. Let me tell you a little something
about
Evan Engram.
For you.
Hey, kid, this Evan Engram kid is really going to do big things for the Jaguars. You know, and where all he's really doing is answering a specific question. Can Evan Engram go deep? Yes, he can. Doug Peterson declares Evan Engram can go deep. So, yes, he can.
The fantasy football community certainly can.
Hey, Evan Engram was phenomenal for the fantasy football community.
No doubt he was. Last year, they did spend a second-round pick on another tight end in last year's draft in Brenton Strange, and the foot injury certainly slowed him down.
No doubt.
About halfway through his rookie year, but Coach was asked this morning about finding more ways to get Brenton Strange on the field.
Yeah, you know, it is and it will. You know, and you know, Brenton's another young tight end that we got to find ways to get on the field and create some matchups. We like what he did last year for us, and we can build upon that. I think that tight end room is a strong room, even with Luke. You know, with Luke in there, and it just again, there's depth and there's stability, which you got to have.
I get that the Eagles used the two tight ends to great effect. Right. Mm-hmm. But keep in mind, when they won the Super Bowl, they hadn't drafted Goddard yet.
Yep.
Right. And then they went out and they spent a first round pick when they already had a pretty good veteran tight end. Now, I think, I'm trying to think back, were Zach Ertz's numbers, I don't know if Zach Ertz's numbers were ever what Evan Engram's were last year, right? Because Engram had such an impact. But Tony, if you are drafting a tight end in today's NFL in the second round and your lead tight end is catching, what was it, 114 balls or whatever? Like, for 1 year, it was a terrible use of resources. Mm-hmm. And maybe Brenton Strange turns into a really good player, but that was the thing with Goddard. Goddard was incorporated fully into that offense, and maybe Strange would have been more so had he not been hurt. But you know, here's Doug talking about, we got to look for ways to get him involved. Okay, well, go out and draft. First of all, if Calvin Ridley came back, which they were attempting to do, how often is Brenton Strange playing ahead of one of Ridley, Kirk, Davis, ETN, Engram? Almost never, except in packages where they're like in short yardage or they're giving you a specific, very limited amount of times, right?
I think that's the – look, we talked about it when Doug got hired here, that the hidden thing about how often he used tight ends was, well, he needed to.
Right.
The wide receiver group wasn't very good.
Right. Alshon Jeffrey was good, but he wasn't out there putting up 1,400 yards to that Eagles team.
And it does feel like with them not bringing Calvin Ridley back, and they didn't make the trade yet for T. Higgins or Ayuk or any of these guys, right? And we'll see what they wind up doing in the draft, but there's the potential that they look at a second-round pick they made last year and say, yeah, we'll get him on the field more.
Well, they might, but out of necessity.
Right. Like, it wouldn't be surprising if that's the direction this whole thing winds up going. And people go, see, I told you, two tight ends. He needs to have two. And it's like, well, he's using what he's got at his disposal. That's what he did in Philadelphia. He did it for his first couple years here in Jacksonville. And now he's doing it again. Like, they're not so strong at wide receiver if they don't add one of those other guys, and they feel good about the guy they drafted in the second round.
Right.
Right, playing along with Evan Engram. Okay.
But, while, and I know you're acknowledging this, all the while they tried to get Calvin Ridley to take their $20 million.
It's not like they didn't want to go that
and
way.
If they had,
yeah.
And if he had taken it, we'd be looking at Brandon yeah. Strange like, when is he ever going to be on the field other than, you know, third and one?
Right.
Again, second round pick investment. And it felt like, and, you know, they talked about almost like, you know, he's such a target of theirs. Despite that, they traded back.
Yeah.
And in trading back, you try to read the room, but you can't know what other teams are going to do. First of all, when you trade back, you're looking at maybe the four or five teams that you're moving behind, right? Well, what happens then when one of those other 20-something teams jumps
back up
into one of those spots, right? So you can't know. So you risked not having him. And maybe they had plenty of pivots there. But, again, that pick more to me is why we don't have Osiris. What is it? Osiris Torrance, right?
Yeah.
I'm saying it in my head. Yeah. I'm like, that doesn't sound right. Right? You know what I mean? Like, you ever do that? And you're like, wait a minute. It's Cyrus O'Shaughnessy. No, it's, you know what I mean? Like, it was right there. I'm like, it's, if I say Osiris Torrance, Tony's going to look at me like I'm crazy because that just doesn't sound right today. All right. Let's get a couple more in here. This on the defensive side. And there'll be more in hour number two on this as well. We talk about Darnell Savage and how he's going to fit in. And there's a little bit of a kind of a sneaky under the radar thing going out there. I certainly don't think anybody was clamoring for Darnell Savage, but they had a specific role in mind, and they went out there and quickly locked him up. And Doug started off this morning talking about his ability to play nickel corner.
His nickel coverage ability inside, his ability to blitz, he's a good tackler, he's a willing tackler. He's a pretty good cover guy, you know. I mean, just all things that we were looking for at that position. And he's got the versatility to play multiple spots, too, on defense. So he does give you that safety flex if you want to do it. He can play that nickel spot if you want to move him in there. We have a young kid, Antonio Johnson, that's going to be a nice little, work in progress there with these two guys. And just excited, again, to get him in and get him working when he can.
Clear to me in listening, and we'll hear another comment from Doug on Savage here in a second, but the hope is Antonio Johnson's ready to take on a full-time role with this defense, you know, and if not, maybe this is way oversimplifying. Yeah, see, he and Savage is a little bit interchangeable, right? And like whatever you're asking one to do, the other probably can do to a fairly respectable degree.
Yeah, and I think this point in the offseason, that's what you should be pushing, right, is we want Johnson to be a starter and be a player for us.
Sure.
Right? Like, that should be the way that you should deal with it now, and maybe you get on the field and say, I don't know, right? And that's what you have coaches for. Well, we're better with this guy playing that position than we are with that guy playing that position. That's why coaches make those decisions ultimately, but in April, you know, there's no reason for it not to be, hey, that kid we took in the fifth, sixth round last year, we think we see something in that. Right, we want to see what that looks like with him having a full-time opportunity and developing into a player. And I think he's going to be fine doing it. I really like Antonio Johnson, but it should be the way that it's being talked about at this point in an offseason. And along those lines, Savage, you just talked about the flexibility that he had, all these different spots. Coach continued to talk about that with Darnell Savage.
I think anymore, you're starting to see more guys with position flexibility. Just like you would offensive linemen, right? You know, guards that can play center, tackles can play both sides, you know, receivers, you can move receivers around. I just think it just helps your overall team. And if you do have an injury at a position, you can plug and play a guy. And so having a guy like Darnell who has that ability to play some safety, even Antonio who we drafted, Antonio can play safety, he can play nickel. So, you know, you got the best of both worlds out of those two guys.
All right, one more here from Doug Peterson. Next hour, we'll get a little more into, like, the culture of this team and what happened down the stretch last year, in addition to some of the other players that they've added in free agency. But just talking about all this positional flexibility with some of the guys that they've signed and given them different options for different looks. Obviously, you've got a new defensive coordinator here in Ryan Nielsen, And Doug Peterson was asked today if that is one of the things that Nielsen really looks for is players that are able to play multiple positions.
Ryan's scheme is a little more four down. And look, you're playing 75%+ anyway in nickel defense, right? So you're always going to be in four down fronts and you're going to always going to play with a nickel, whether it's a normal nickel body or a big nickel, as third safety, teams want to call it sometimes. But yeah, it's all part of what Ryan wants to do and what he wants to get accomplished.
All right, so look, we always have this seemingly annual debate, right? 3-4 versus 4-3, what's the best use of the personnel? And then we hear the coach say, oh, it doesn't matter that much because, 75%.
We're doing both.
We're doing both. We're nickel. We're going to be multiple, Tony. Got to say multiple in there several times during these press conferences to get the NFL buzzwords in. But he says more of a four-down guy. And then he says, well, we're in four-down anyway because the nickel 75% of the time. Well, sounds like good chunk of that other 25 you're going to be in four-down.
Yeah.
Or four-down lineman looks, right? So, okay. So Josh Allen and Trayvon are your edges, okay? Armstead, Devon Hamilton, Armstead, Roy Robertson, Harris, whatever the rotation is at any given moment, your defensive tackles.
Mm-hmm.
Foyer is your middle, and I suppose that makes Devin Lloyd your weak side. Is Travis Gibson your starting strong side linebacker?
Could be.
Might be, right?
Yeah.
I mean, is there a better option on this team right now?
Seems like a good excuse to draft a linebacker.
It might be, right? Yeah. And we joke about that, but yeah. It may be like one of those, a little bit one of those hidden needs for this football team based on how they want to line up and play. That doesn't mean they couldn't use more edge rush. They couldn't use more defensive tackle prowess.
Absolutely.
Whatever. But this specifically, you're looking at maybe a strong side linebacker, a guy who can cover tight ends, a guy who can do some different things. And maybe they think Devin Lloyd can do some of that stuff. I've seen him get lost in coverage plenty of times, though. However, I hope. Whatever abilities they think Devin Lloyd has, Ryan Nielsen's able to unlock him.
Let's go.
Let him pass rush a little bit more, whatever. I mean, you spent multiple picks to trade up into the first round to get this guy, and he's been an okay player, but he's not been an impact player to this point in time. So it does sound like you're going to see more of a base 4-3 look from this football team, and you'll hear Doug Peterson later on one of the favorite subjects of Jaguars fans talking about Trayvon Walker sliding inside on third down and some of those looks as well. And we'll get to that coming up. D-Rock going to join us. Mike DiRocco in Orlando for the owners' meetings this morning, sitting right next to Dougie P. We'll get the firsthand perspective from ESPN's Mike DiRocco joining us as we kick off Hour 2 of Jaguars Today. Straight ahead, Mike Dempsey, Tony Smith, and Dylan Denmark on 1010XL and 92.5 FM.
Jaguars Today.
From the Jacksonville Orthopedic Institute Studios.
JOI, where the pros go.
Hi there, I'm Steve Spurrier on 1010XL, 92.5 FM.
1010XL.
Lamb of God and Mastodon live. Celebrating 20 years of Ashes of the Wake and Leviathan. July 23rd, Daly's Place. With special guests, Kerry King and Malevolence. Lamb of God and Mastodon's Ashes of Leviathan Tour. Tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com.
Daily's Dash is not only your Jaguars game day stop, but a great place to grab a meal any day of the week. To honor the Jags and the fans, we've crafted the Duval Sub. The Duval comes with freshly sliced turkey, ham, melted cheddar, and habanero jack cheese, topped with crisp lettuce, fresh tomatoes, and a double portion of our secret sauce, all served on a fresh roll. Come by your local's Daily's Dash today to get your delicious Duval Sub. Daily's is the official convenience store sponsor of the Jacksonville Jaguars.
The 2024 NFL season is approaching fast, and the Jaguars are celebrating their 30th season. Be at the bank for all the big plays and big moments of this milestone year by locking in your season tickets now. With packages for every budget and exclusive perks throughout the season, there's no better time to become a season ticket member. Be at the bank for every touchdown, and secure your seats by going to jaguars.com/tickets or call 904-633-2000 today. We'll see you at the bank.
ET here, and it's time for the Taste of Golf at TPC Sawgrass, April 24th.
Join me for fine cuisine from chefs from the top golf clubs in our area. Craft cocktails, games, and unique auction items. This is one of the most charitable events in our area. Come network with a sophisticated audience who is passionate about golf and its values, all while impacting the youth in our community. All proceeds benefit First Tee North Florida. For tickets, go to tastethegolf.com. Come on, somebody.
To thank you for 40 unforgettable years, Dell Technologies is celebrating with anniversary savings on their most popular tech. For a limited time only, save on select next-gen PCs, like the XPS 13 Plus, powered by Intel Core processors, and more. Plus, curate your dream setup with great deals on select monitors, mice, and more must-have electronics and accessories. When you shop online at Dell.com/deals, you'll have access to leading-edge technology and free shipping on everything. Again, that's Dell.com/deals.
Let's go! Don't miss the Jacksonville Sharks' first home game against the IFL defending champion Bay Area Panthers next Saturday, April 6th, at the Vistar Veterans Memorial Arena, kickoff 7 p.m. Let's go! Let's show them what we got. Let's go! Tickets as low as $15. You can't find Saturday family affordable fun anywhere else. Call 904-621-0700 or go to jacksharks.com. Dust off your boots, grab your cowboy hat for Western night. Join us at 5 p.m. for Shark Fest, every home game located outside the arena for our pregame party. Help us rock the tank as we roll out the 2023 NAL Championship. Let's go! Don't miss opening night of the season next Saturday, April 6th, 7 o'clock in the Vistar Veterans Memorial Arena. Be a part of indoor football fun and exciting non-stop action. For tickets as low as $15, call 904-621-0700. Don't forget your cowboy hats. Let's go!
The flagship station of the Jaguars. WJXL AM Jacksonville Beach. WJXL FM Jacksonville Beach.
Hey, Hicken here, or just call me Danny Dreamfinders. For a limited time on select move-in ready homes, Dreamfinders Homes is offering an amazing 3.99% interest rate in year one of your mortgage. Now is your chance to lock down the rate. You heard me right. 3.99% offer in year one. Visit DreamFindersHomes.com for sales event information and get the game. Interest rate available on select move-in ready homes. Restrictions and limitations apply. Go to DreamFindersHomes.com for more details.
Hi, I'm Sean Monahan from Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach. Since 1977, we've been Jacksonville's family jeweler, where our true specialty is engagement rings and custom jewelry design. And now, buy your diamond engagement ring at Monahan's and get any diamond wedding band and men's wedding bands for 50% off. Come in and be treated like family for one of the most important purchases of your life. Buy your diamond engagement ring right now at Monahan's and get any diamond wedding band and gents band for 50% off. Come to Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach or book an appointment at MonahanJewelry.com.
What is the world's largest freshwater lake? The internet.
How long has it been since you compared homeowners insurance rates? Log on to SouthernOak.com to get an instant quote or find an agent near you.
Our family protecting yours, Southern Oak Insurance.
Lake Superior has enough water to cover North and South America combined. It is the world's largest freshwater lake.
Southern Oak Insurance, our family protecting yours.
This is Molly McDonald with your 1010XL Southeast Orthopedic Specialist Local Sports Update, brought to you by First Coast Honda Dealers. Number 6 Florida Baseball claims the weekend series over number 5 LSU by a final score of 12-2 on Sunday afternoon, making this Florida's first series win in Baton Rouge since 2011. Pitcher Jack Caglione went for a season high of 7 innings, allowing just 2 runs. FSU baseball crumbles to Clemson this weekend, snapping their undefeated season with a 14-12 loss Sunday afternoon. Florida and Florida State meet in Jacksonville at 1-1 Financial Ballpark for the Sunshine Showdown tomorrow. First pitch at 6. You can listen to the game live on 1010 AM. Skating their way towards the Kelly Cup, the Jacksonville Icemen remain second in the ECHL South after securing a win over the Swamp Rabbits Saturday night 4-3. It's 71 degrees at 11 o'clock. Time and temp brought to you by Bueller Air Conditioning. Stay cooler with Bueller.
XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555, Jacksonville. Everything you need to know about the Jags. Jaguars today on 1010XL.
All right, awaiting the arrival of the truth speaker, Michael DeRocco. Big fan of Spandau Ballet as well. Just big fan of ballet in general. Does a great job covering the Jaguars for ESPN, one of our regular Jaguars Today co-hosts and a big-time Breakfast Bowl loser, at least this year, like all of us other than Tony.
I'm a back-to-back winner.
I know. Not happy about that.
I'm the only one with my name on the trophy twice.
Yeah, I might smash that trophy. I might go old school, like the drill. Can't have it. Yeah. For me, nobody's
put it in the
it.
Urinal. Yeah.
That's right. That's right. Several people have suggested, in terms of the strong side linebacker position, options on the Jags. You see Abdullah, right? He's easy to forget when he's not even active, when he's healthy on game day. But Ventrell Miller, another guy who we just don't know, you know? Like,
yeah,
is he ever going to be healthy?
Right. Like, I think those are names that will certainly be given a shot to play it.
Sure.
Right? Whether or not they can do it effectively or not.
And do they look at it and go, we got Travis Gibson, we got these other two guys, someone will emerge out of that group.
Yeah.
You know, in the
they could certainly look at it that way, but with the way that they've handled linebacker, you know, for the last 4 or 5 years,
draft three.
It wouldn't be a surprise at all if they look at it and say, no, it's a need. Right? And they address it in the draft. Like, it's yeah, you can point out the 3-4 names that might be able to play that spot for him. I agree with you. They might be able to play that spot for him. But might is not will play that spot for him. And if they don't draft a guy and they say, we'll let these guys hash it out among themselves, okay. Like, I don't have a big problem if that's the direction they go with it. But I wouldn't be surprised at all if they say, no, we'll draft a guy. He'll be our outside linebacker there.
No, I'm with you. I think it could go either way. I don't look at it as like a position I'm prioritizing.
No, they don't have to.
I think you got bigger fish to fry, bigger needs, so to speak, whatever, at the moment. But, you know, if they're playing more of a four-down look, which it certainly seems like they're going to, and it's not always going to be nickel, and because obviously in nickel situations, and, you know, the defensive back that comes in takes the place of one of those guys.
I wouldn't answer strong side linebacker as one of the positions that they're pretty good at right now.
I would agree with that, but I also wouldn't answer it as one of their biggest needs right now.
No, but our question of the day is, what is the strongest position group? Like, strong side linebacker is not that group. You know, like, they have a bunch of guys that might be able to play that spot, but they don't have anybody that I'm like, yeah, that's the strong side linebacker, doofus. Like, there's none of that going on with the roster right now.
All right, Tony just called somebody a doofus.
It's mostly me.
Well, true. All right, as we await the arrival of Mike DeRocco, let's hear a little bit more from Dougie P talking about the way they collapsed last season, and they don't want to look at that as being anything close to their standard.
Yeah, obviously as a coach, you're hopeful that that's the motivation, right? I mean, the way we finished the last month and a half is not our standard, and it's not what we talk about. It goes against everything we talk about, really. And we still had opportunities all the way to the 18th week of the regular season. So, you know, we're there at the end. We just got to figure out a way to kind of push through that envelope and be there. And credit Houston. I mean, they battled their tails off all year. They were much like us a year ago in 22. We had to battle our tails off to get where we got to. So credit to D'Amico and his staff and those players in Houston, you know, for winning the division the way they did.
I would like to be a head coach for a day just to see how the money would be great, but just to see how I would react, right? The next question we're getting to here is about culture. We've talked about that over and over and over again. And from my perspective, every time that question gets asked, I'm like, yeah, if they win, it's good culture. If they lose, it's bad culture.
Right.
Right? Like that kind
I'm
of
with
thing.
You.
Like, do coaches feel the same way? You know, every time they get that question, are they like, well, you know, I don't really know how to answer this. We want a good culture. What else do you want me to say?
Did you hear Freddie T this morning with the drill? And Fred was basically like saying that same thing. If you win, that's good culture.
Yeah.
You know? And they're going to say you have good culture anyway.
Virtually every time these coaches step up to a podium anywhere, they get asked about their team culture and what they're doing to, you know, enhance the culture in the locker room and do these different things. And, you know, Doug was no exception this morning when he was asked about the culture of the team coming out of that collapse and what kind of culture he wants to get established here in Jacksonville.
this is the culture that I want to establish in Jacksonville, and this is the reason why you go get guys like Mitch Morse and Eric Armsteads and the Darnell Savages and guys that have been to the postseason. These guys have been captains on their teams, and you know they've been to Super Bowls, they've been to AFC Championship games. You know, so these guys know how to win, and that's kind of the influx of talent that we want to bring onto this our young roster, guys that have been there, done that, and you know, again, it's just I've got to continue to message the team in the right way, and you know, there's got to be a sort of a confidence about you that, you know, when you take the field on game day, that hey, you know, yeah, you there's gonna be game, you're gonna get beat, I understand that, but you got to have that confidence and that swagger that you know you're gonna get the job done, you know, on game day, and I think bringing in some of these free agents we did this spring are going to help that.
It's an expectation that you're not going to settle for just showing up and collecting your money, which, by the way, we'd say $8 million is probably on the lower end of NFL head coaches.
Some of it. Probably, like, I don't know what.
I don't know. Getting. I think the higher end, though, is pushing up in the high teens, right? So would $8 million surprise you as like a third year head coach's salary, something like that? I don't think it would be that surprising, right? If you were making $8 million and you got paid on
a
daily
basis,
the average
is 6.6.
Ah, damn it! All right, well, I was all set. 6.6 million, right? All right, let's see here. 6.6 million divided by 365. I just want to find out how much money Tony would make. $18,000 today. You'd make $18,000.
That'd be nice.
If you got paid on a daily basis, I'd take that.
No doubt.
Kidding me? Work a week. See you next year. All right. So how many teams, when asked about what's your culture? Oh, we want to be physical. What team doesn't want to be physical? Right? You know what I mean? Like, you ever hear a team go, we really want to outsmart them and finesse them. You know what I mean? We don't feel like we need to have the strongest lines of scrimmage because we're going to trick
them
up.
The teams who do that say they want to be strong.
They all say, right? We want to be physical, impose our will. It almost becomes like
the greatest show on turf weren't going to the podium saying, we're going to run around you in circles and
super athletic. We'll tell you we're physical. They actually had a pretty good defense.
They did.
You know, they had a good pass rush. And, you know, exactly. You look at when you've got twitchy skill position players, you can't possibly be a physical team. Sometimes there's that feeling, right, that gets transmitted. So where are we at here? The collapse last year. Doug Peterson said this really impacted him. And quite frankly, you know, even though the next year's a new year, chance to start over, you don't really ever get over those kind of finishes.
For me, it's not so much that loss as much as it is the last, you know, six games. When we were sitting there at 8-3 and we had everything going for us and right in front of us. I don't know if I'll ever get over it. I think for me, it's going to be my motivation, my fuel, you know, moving forward. You know, and I'm not going to let it cloud the vision, but at the same time, it's going to be close in my mind as I move forward with the team this spring.
I wonder, Tone, and I'm not trying to make it like, you know, Eric Armstead's going to come in and give these locker room speeches or anything like that. You know, I don't think that plays well too frequently on a professional level. I think the well-timed occasional speech, absolutely. We heard about the Travis Kelce one before the Super Bowl, but you can't go to that every single week kind of situation, right? So, but I do wonder that if things start sliding and you're 8-3 and it's starting to get away from you, you lose one. Oh, we let that one get away. We're okay. And you lose another. We're still okay. Well, does having the presence of, you know, a guy in Eric Armstead who's been to a couple Super Bowls. Yeah. Gabe Davis and Mitch Morse are used to making at least semi-deep runs, at times deep, or at least, you know, getting to the postseason, winning a game, being considered among the favorites. Does that raise the level of maybe an expectation's not the right word, but of enough is enough? You know, like, are we getting closer to a critical mass of players that are like, whoa, let's recognize this before it becomes a problem, before it becomes that snowball rolling down the hill where all of a sudden we're asking, how do we get into a four-game losing streak? Does that have any tangible impact to trying to drag a team out of a situation where it feels like it's going wrong on every front?
Anyone who's been a longtime dedicated fan of any sports team, right, at any kind of level, the things that you think about when you think about that fandom are not the victories, right? Like the things that come to your mind when you're asked about your history as a Yankees fan or a Braves fan or a Jaguars fan, whatever it happens to be for you, the thing you think about is the scar, right? It's not the victory, it's the scar. And what happened over the back half of last season, Doug Peterson's in the middle of it, right? Like fans are going to feel that scar for a while. They feel 99. They're never going to let that go, right? Like those kind of things just don't go away. Well, Doug Peterson happened to be here while they were experiencing that one. So if the team ever does succeed at a high level during his tenure here in Jacksonville, and I certainly think they're still capable of doing that, but when that happens, then the thing that they're going to be reacting to when they win big is going to be like, you remember how bad that felt, right? Like even when they're on top, they're going to be like, you remember how bad that was?
Yes.
That's why we're here, right? Like that's why we pushed ourselves to succeed. Those are the things that push, you know, push everybody forward is you remember how bad that felt? Never again, right? Like that's the thing that keeps professional athletes motivated is I'm never going to have to experience that again.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not putting myself or my teammates through that ever again.
You hate the losing more than you love the winning sometimes.
Absolutely. And one more here from Coach Peterson from this morning. He was asked about what does Arik Armstead bring to this defensive line?
First of all, he's played a ton of football. You know, Trent has familiarity with him, drafted him in San Francisco. He's been an outstanding player for them, obviously, and somebody, that a player that, you know, we got Josh Allen, who's, you know, a fifth-year guy. Trayvon's a young second-year guy, or going into his third. This is somebody that can come in and I think can really, number one, help Trayvon, you know, continue to grow, but at the same time give us what we need with the scheme that Ryan Nielsen wants to employ. By having the pieces there, he can play defensive end. He can move inside on third down. He can, you know, same with Trayvon. He can play end. He can move inside. There's a lot of different things. And then you add Roy Robertson. You add Devon. You know, Josh in there. I mean, there's the making of a potentially good defensive line by adding a guy like Arik and his credibility, his work ethic. And just the amount of football and where he's, you know, where he's played.
He caught himself there, right? Like, I think he wanted to say, I kind of like what we got up here. And he's like, all right, we get the makings of maybe something good. Huh? Right? Right? Like, I didn't feel like, let's just not get ahead of ourselves. But you start looking at the names and you're like, if Devon can bounce back and be the guy we thought we were signing last year, Roy Robertson-Harris is fine as a third defensive tackle in a rotation. If Arik Armstead is what we expect him to be, a guy who, you know, should push in that 7-8 sack range, and really his impact might be felt more statistically on what the ends do as opposed to what he does. But you've got a 17.5 sack end. You got Trayvon, who went into double digits last year. You added Trevis Gibson as another pass rush option. It's not perfect, but you could see some of the pieces being there. You have depth at defensive tackle. Is it great? Well, it wasn't great last year, but if Armstead pushes everybody down a peg in terms of what their role is going to be, Foley's out the door, Armstead upgrades that position. I think Doug feels like they're sneaky good at that. And, you know, look, you can consider defensive line a position group if you want to. You can break it down even further. Today we're asking you, with the major work being done in free agency, what do you consider to be the Jags' strongest position group at this point in time? Still time for you to hit us up, but we have connected with the great one, Mike DiRocco, down in Orlando. He does have other employers he has to take care of from time to time. So apparently he's doing some ESPN work, but he will join us coming out of this break that we'll take right now. We'll get a firsthand look from DiRocco on what he picked up from Doug Peterson this morning. More to come from Doug Peterson, by the way, today on 1010XL. He spoke for quite a long time this morning, and you'll hear throughout the course of the afternoon, I'm sure, some of the various host thoughts on what the head coach of the Jaguars had to say. But we'll get D-Rock's perspective on that straight ahead. You're listening to Jaguars Today here on 1010XL and 92.5 FM.
Jaguars Today from the Jacksonville Orthopedic Institute Studios. Come aboard the Frangie Express.
Pedal to the metal right now.
Pedal to the metal.
All right, let's go.
Frank Frangie, Hayes Carline, and Lauren Brooks. They are the Frangie Show. Afternoons on 1010XL.
At Duck Duck Rooter, we understand plumbing issues can be a real inconvenience for your building or business, and we're here to help. We can handle all kinds of plumbing jobs, including broken pipes, clogged drains, line jetting, installing water heaters, and full repipes. Need a camera inspection or a smoke test? Yes, Duck Duck Rooter does that too. Plus, our lift station services include inspections, monitoring, cleaning, and repairs. When you're stuck, call the Duck. 904-862-6769. That's 904-862-6769.
When you think about a metal roof, think Prime Roofing. Prime Roofing is Jacksonville's local contractor that manufactures, fabricates, and installs metal roofs. Schedule today at PrimeRoofingFL.com. That's PrimeRoofingFL.com.
Need protection? Call Craig and Christine Kaprosky at Goosehead Insurance. The Kaproskys are a husband and wife team committed to finding you the right coverage at the right price in just a few short minutes. For home, auto, flood, or specialty insurance, Craig and Christine Kaprosky are the answer. Craig.Kaprosky at Goosehead.com.
Bring your marketing to the next level with 3D Digital, your local video production and digital marketing agency that specializes in ensuring your brand's story is seen, heard, and remembered. Our award-winning team creates professional content that will be launched across multiple platforms to precisely target your audience. Call us at 904-712-4004 or visit 3ddigital.com to define, design, and deliver exceptional results for your business.
Sometimes the most important position in sports needs a translator.
I'm Denny Thompson, and they call me the quarterback whisperer.
He shares his insights Friday mornings on The Drill. Brought to you by Tyson Sound and Security and George Moore Chevrolet.
Have you tried golfing at the improved Cimarron Golf Club? If you haven't, tell you what, you're missing out on the best deal in Jacksonville. Now, many of you have received a postcard in the mail, and of course, if you bring that with you, $45 plus tax to play. That includes a cart, lunch, and a beer at the brand new Stone Barrel Tap House. Now, go to the website, that is CimarronGolfClub.com, and sign up for the Wild One Loyalty Program. That's the Wild One Loyalty Program, and get all of these specials emailed to you from Cimarron.
It's March basketball. That means a host of top teams will be competing for the NCAA title. When it comes to commercial painters, there's also some healthy competition out there. Jason Parker with Performance Painting. To help you know the right questions to ask any painter competing for your business this year, visit PerformancePaintingJax.com. Or if you're ready for a friendly quote, give us a call and ask about our free pressure wash promotion for your next project. Performance Painting, quality coatings applied with pride.
Performance Painting!
Imagine driving a late model Corvette, BMW, Mercedes, Lexus, Honda, Chevy, Ford, and more, all at a fraction of the original sticker price. Visit Vaughn Motor Group's indoor showroom and browse a great selection of dream cars that are inspected with warranties. Before you make your next auto purchase, check out Vaughn Motor Group on San Jose Boulevard or at VaughnMotorGroup.com for a complete inventory listing. If you can dream it, you can drive it at Vaughn Motor Group.
Attention veterans, if you have a VA loan, you need to listen to this, especially if your current rate is higher than 6.5%. Now is the time to take advantage of the federal government's VA Streamline Refinance Program. With my friends at Loan Pronto, you can. Go to LoanPronto.com. Prosser here, and Loan Pronto has fixed rate APRs in the fives. You can drop your rate now. Lower your payment with no income documentation and no appraisal. Do it at LoanPronto.com. Their all-digital platform makes it easy. They can even cover your closing costs. If you need cash now, Loan Pronto can get you up to 100% of your home value. You can pay off all your credit cards or other debt and save as much as $1,000 a month. Call Loan Pronto now at 904-999-1508 or get a 30-second rate quote at LoanPronto.com. Ask about streamlined VA loans. No income doc and no appraisal. Loan Pronto, 999-1508 or LoanPronto.com. Equal housing lender, NMLS 1661781, subject to lender approval.
Hi, this is Dave Barker. Multi-unit hair grafting is now available at IHRS and can give you three times more hair in one procedure over a traditional hair transplant.
Multi-unit hair grafting gave me more hair in one procedure and within my budget.
You can grow your hair back with this exclusive new procedure. Call for a free evaluation. Call IHRS 904-7000. 777-IHRS. 777-IHRS. 777-4477.
It's Kubota Orange Days, your golden chance to score a deal that will make your neighbors green with envy. Shop the year's best selection of Kubota tractors, zero-turn mowers, and utility vehicles, including the number one selling compact tractor in the USA. And get the year's best deals, like 0% APR for 84 months or up to $3,300 off L3302 tractors. Coastal Equipment on New Kings Road and in McClenny.
Coastal Equipment.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. Let's ring up another guest on the All-Pro Roofing phone line.
Jaguars Today
on 1010XL.
Double dose of the ballet this morning, Tony.
He had to have it.
Gotta have it. Yeah. Everything Mike DiRocco says is true. We love him. D-Rock at the owner's meetings. What's up, D-Rock? How are you, sir?
I'm good, guys. How are y'all?
We appreciate you joining us. We know you've got, you know, duties that pay you from ESPN. You have to. And we understand the pecking order, and that is quite fine. And we appreciate you coming on today. Looked like you had a front row seat. You were sitting right next to Dougie P this morning, right?
Yeah, it was a wonderful breakfast this morning, hanging out with Dougie for like 30 minutes. A lot of good stuff talked about today, yeah.
Yeah, and he did. He seemed very relaxed. You tell me, like, sometimes you see the few minutes beforehand, a few minutes afterhand. You know, just what was the general mood or sense that you get about how he feels about where things stand at this point in the offseason?
Encouraged, I think. You know, there's still concern about several areas, obviously, and you know, Trevor Lawrence cutting down the turnovers is one of them, and the offensive line trying to stay healthy and getting better in the middle there is another one, getting the run game going, figuring out what they're doing at corner and you know, those kind of things. But, you know, he was pretty loose, and, you know, this is a low-key setting down here, which is really good to get the coaches in this setting because they are, I think, a little bit more open. Than, you know, normally during the season or even, you know, at the draft or free agency press conferences. You know, they're, you know, it's a resort here and they're just kind of, you know, here with their families and a couple of days here, and then they're going to take some more time off and head back up. So real, you know, productive, I thought, press conference with Doug today.
Was there anything that you felt like was an open question before you heard from Doug that is an answered question now that you've heard from him?
Well, you know, I thought the most interesting thing, I don't necessarily think there was anything that I didn't, you know, that there was this burning question, you know, that we had to have answered today. But I do think, you know, him talking about, I'm not sure I'm ever going to get over the fall off after the 8-3 start, I thought was, to me, the most newsworthy thing, you know, that, you know, look, like I think Tony talking about beforehand, before the break, yeah, you know, fans are never going to get over that. That's 100% sure. But you know, it still bothered him too. And that, you know, and this is what I'm writing for tomorrow, that shaped what they did this offseason and played a role in the kinds of guys and the specific guys that they brought in. Yeah, they brought in guys to address positional needs too, but those guys had some of those other qualities that they were looking for to kind of hopefully ensure that something like that doesn't happen again.
So is that a pretty clear indication that they felt like the DNA of that locker room just needed some more of that, D-Rock? And part of it is, you know, if you've been with this Jaguar team, you haven't had a lot of playoff experience because they haven't been to the playoffs very often. You know, Tony and I were just debating that. You've got a guy in Armstead who's been to a couple Super Bowls. You know, Davis and Morse are used to going to the postseason, probably winning a game, maybe making a deep run. Having more of that in your locker room as things start to slip away, can that have that tangible impact of, whoa, let's not take this for granted? Like, can that, having those kind of guys refocus, would more of those guys maybe have saved what happened down the stretch last year, I guess I'm asking?
Yeah, I think to me the most important quote of the entire 2023 season was after the Titans loss in Nashville and Josh Allen standing there talking about, you know, we got that spark in 2022 when we rode that to the division title in the playoffs. And he's like, you know, we kept standing around waiting for that spark to come again this year in 2023, and it just never came. And, you know, that I don't want to, you know, it is a young team, but, you know, those guys had not been in the situation of we made the playoffs, now we've got to get back there again and take that next step. And they admittedly, you know, Doug Peterson said today he thinks they may have gotten a little too comfortable after that 8-3 start. Now, yeah, did the injuries play a factor into it? Absolutely. Trevor was beat up, you know, the second half of the year. Christian Kirk not being there was a significant deal. Zay Jones being banged up pretty much all year was not great. And, you know, the injuries along the offensive line, too. But, you know, a guy like Mitch Morse, who's been in an AFC title game, been in the playoffs, you know, 5, 6, 7 years in a row. Gabe Davis, same kind of thing. You got Eric Armstead, who's played in the Super Bowl, been NFC title games. You know, those kind of guys, Devin Duvernay, you know, as well as, you know, they were in the AFC title game. You know, those kind of guys who have been there, been through that, and understand the rigors of it, not just doing it once, but doing it multiple times. I think having that in your locker room in the situation last year would have been incredibly valuable. Because as much as a good leader, as much as the chemistry was really good in that locker room, and the leadership I thought was really good in that locker room, it's one thing to be a leader in there. It's another thing to be a leader and have the perspective of this is what it takes to keep doing this over and over and over again. Maybe one of those guys might have been able to grab everybody and shake them free and say, hey, look, we're not waiting for the spark. We got to make the spark. Mm-hmm.
D-Rock, where has the team improved the most this offseason in your view?
Center. I think that's like everyone's – I was talking with a couple of people around here, and, you know, the Armstead signing's fantastic. I mean, I think that's a really, really good signing for this team. And, you know, the Gabe Davis signing, I thought was really good as well. It's going to give them something on offense that they didn't really have. But to me, the most important signing was Mitch Morse and shoring up the middle of that offensive line. And I think that's going to make a world of difference. You know, we don't have to go into all the problems that Fortner has had last year. I mean, we all saw it. We knew that that was a major weakness. You know, they feel like getting Ezra Cleveland healthy will be a significant thing. Keeping Cam Robinson healthy will be significant as well. But, man, that was the weak spot. I mean, you can't do anything offensively when it's all up in the middle of your face. And the defense is right there in your quarterback's face all the time. And Morse makes this team – it sounds weird to say, oh, it's just the center, but he makes this team significantly better. And I think we'll see a huge improvement in the run game, and I think we'll see a huge improvement in terms of Trevor Lawrence not having guys in his face all the time.
That would be ideal, right? I mean, we certainly could go for that, D-Rock. And I think they think, you know, as well that we're going to get a better year out of Ezra Cleveland as well if he's healthier. And, you know, we'll see. Cam Robinson at this point, what, mortal lock for the opening day roster, high 90%? Or you think there's still a decent chance that something could happen at that position?
I'm more of in the high 90% that okay. He's going to be the starting left tackle. You know, I don't expect them to take a tackle at 17. I really don't. I think corner, if the right corners are there, will be the play. And if not, then maybe wide receiver, depending on who's around. But I think Cam's going to be that left tackle. Now, something could happen. Someone could call them and offer them, you know, over the next couple of weeks, something. You never know. Like, you know, who would have thought Mac Jones would have been traded here to Jacksonville? So you really never know. But I feel like that's we know what the start right now. If we wrote down what we thought the starting offensive line would be for September, that I think it's the same group right now that will be there in September.
D-Rock, we've seen how interested they were in bringing back Calvin Ridley. They were involved to whatever degree they were involved in trading for Brandon Ayuk, even if that didn't turn out. With them getting that deal done. So they're obviously interested in adding a top-of-the-depth-chart wide receiver during this offseason. With that not having gotten done for them yet, how likely do you think that is for them to address with the first-round pick they have?
First or second, I would say. I think, to me, the biggest weakness on this team is corner. And if the corner they like is there at 17, I think that's where they go. And if not, then I think it probably could be wide receiver, just depending on the names that are available there. But again, ask for wide receivers. So if they feel like they have to take that corner at 17, they should be able to come back and get somebody they like, you know, in the second round. But, you know, it's a major need. This team does not have that young guy that can grow with Trevor Lawrence over the next 5, 6, 7 years. And this team's history in drafting receivers, you know, and history is, you know, not an indicator of future success, but it's not been good. You know, they've only drafted, what, two guys that have ever had 1,000-yard seasons? And that's DJ Chark and Allen Robinson. Allen Hurns was a free undrafted free agent that they signed. So,
by the way, Chark and Robinson both available, D-Rock, just pointing it out.
yes, they are. I think if you drafted, if signed both of them, you would probably end up with somewhere around 800 yards combined.
There you go.
Those guys. But, I mean, it's a need. They need to have, you know, and I'm not sure, you know, if they draft a guy at 17 at receiver, you know, how you have to see what these guys are, obviously. But, you know, he would not have to come in immediately and be the number one guy. So that would be helpful, you know, in terms of development. Because I still think, with a healthy Zay Jones and Kirk and Ingram, adding Gabe Davis to that, I think that's a pretty darn good receiving core. And remember, this was a group that had Marvin Jones the year before and was a top 10 offense. And I think Gabe Davis is probably an upgrade over Marvin Jones. So they've got playmakers. They just need to stay healthy. But wide receiver is a big need for this team for sure.
D-Rock, I'm sorry, go ahead, Tom.
No, I was just going to say, if you're not sick of this question already, D-Rock, I'm sure you will be between now and July when we can stop asking it. What do you expect the timeline to be for getting a long-term deal done with Josh Allen?
I'm expecting it to – I don't think it'll be like a deadline deal like the Evan Ingram was just before the deadline for the franchise tag guy to sign, or he's got to play on the franchise tag. I wouldn't be surprised if there's something done before the draft, but I don't think it's going to drag all the way into July. I'm expecting something, you know, before we get to July.
Atta baby, D-Rock. I want a little positivity on that front, so I appreciate that. I don't know if you're right.
Tomorrow. Yes, it's going to happen tomorrow. Let me help you guys out.
Excellent.
Tomorrow.
Mike DiRocco says ESPN cannot be trusted. No, I'm just kidding. Of course, you're the top of the food chain. D-Rock, we're just talking about strong side linebacker a little bit because, you know, Doug said, hey, you know, Ryan Nielsen's more of a four down front guy, and then they always go to the, oh, we're a nickel anyway, 75%
of the
time.
Josh Allen can certainly do that, and I'd rather have him as the end.
Right, and all that, right, exactly. Yeah. All that is fine, right? But if it is a base 4-3, there are going to be times when you're not a nickel and you got four down linemen. So who's your strong side linebacker, D-Rock? Is it Travis Gibson? Is it Yasir Abdullah? Is it Ventrell Miller? Is it throw all those guys in the mix and see what emerges? Is it a draft position that they might be looking at? How do you see that going?
Yes.
Yes, all the above.
I think all of them, honestly. I mean, it's really – I really want to get to OTAs so we can see what that is going to look like and see what Nielsen's lineup is going to look like, I guess. But, you know, that's a position that we probably don't talk a lot about, but we just – you know, you don't know who's going to be there. I think pretty much everywhere else, for the most part, you could tell, you know, who the starter is going to be at most of those other spots. And that one right there, you're just like, Abdullah's intriguing because he doesn't fit as a pass rusher in the 4-3. I don't think, I mean, he's undersized and it's just not, he's just not a 4-3 guy. So, that's the intriguing name for me. But also, you know, there's other guys there. Ventrell Miller, you know, the Jags loved Ventrell Miller, absolutely loved him. His problem is he can't stay healthy.
Right.
When he was healthy, he was a really, really good player. So I don't think you can go into the season saying, yeah, we feel pretty comfortable with Miller and Abdullah over there because you haven't seen either one of them play. They're going to draft someone on for that position at some point, I would think, in the draft, not high, but maybe middle to low round. So we'll have to see how it plays out. But it's probably the biggest question if you're sitting there going, hey, well, we can kind of figure out most of this defense, but that's the spot where we probably can't at this point.
Yeah, and again, you know, that may only be, I don't know, 10% of the snaps or 15% of the snaps, but for those snaps, that's still important, and it is something that we don't know the firm answer to right now, and they may not either, right? They may just be a case of they've got these pieces, they're going to throw them all in there and see what emerges as their best option right now. All right, Mike DiRocco of ESPN, and of course of Jaguars Today fame as well, checking in from the owners' meetings. D-Rock, what can we look forward to? I was predicting you might be writing a piece on tight ends because you asked about Evan Engram. Could I be right about that?
Yeah, ding, 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 ding.
Yeah,
yeah,
baby.
Absolutely.
I know the business. Come on.
Yeah, and also a couple of those tight ends questions for one of my colleagues at ESPN is doing like a general tight end story. I'm working more on an Engram story there. But, yeah, I mean, the next step for Engram is being a guy that can make some plays downfield. And that's partly, you know, the way the Jags chose to use him. And, you know, maybe we'll see that change if Brenton Strange becomes a guy that they, you know, get more involved in the offense. And we can see maybe Engram stretching the field at times and going up the seam and making some plays in the seam, which is an area the Jaguars really did not attack much with the tight end last year. So, yeah, I'm interested to see how it plays out. It's going to be fun to watch. I mean, I'm excited about this offseason, which sounds weird considering what happened last season and how disappointing it ended and feel like, oh, my gosh, they've got a lot of work to do. Absolutely, they got a lot of work to do. But that, to me, is kind of fun. It's like, how do they bounce back? How do they handle this? You got guys coming off good years, guys coming off not good years, and that's always fun to watch.
All right, Mike DiRocco, you can find him on the Twitter or X platform at ESPN DiRocco, and look for his notes on the owners' meetings at ESPN.com and that feature on the tight ends, as well as specifically Evan Engram and what the Jags are going to do at that position and everything else from DiRock forthcoming. Mike, we appreciate the time as always. And are you down? You come back today? You're down there for a couple of days? What's the situation?
Yeah, I'm going to stick around tomorrow, help out with the NFC coaches' breakfast, okay. And then I'll be home tomorrow evening.
All right, brother. Well, safe travels, and let's go stick a peg in the ground.
Absolutely. Looking forward to that for sure.
I will be in touch, all right? We'll see you, Mike. There he goes, Mike DiRocco of ESPN, one of our favorite guys around these parts. Of course, a weekly co-host on Jaguars Today throughout the NFL season as well. All right, we'll come back, Tony. Let's talk about what's the strongest position group, or what we see as at least the candidates for the strongest position group currently on the Jacksonville Jaguars. We'll debate and discuss today's question of the day when we return in a moment. You're listening to Jaguars Today. Keep it right here on 1010XL and 92.5 FM.
Jaguars Today from the JOI Studios at 1010XL.
Hey, this is Donnie Edwards, former NFL linebacker. Just want to give a shout-out to our men and women serving in our military, especially in the city of Jacksonville. And you're listening to 1010XL Jacksonville Sports Radio.
I was on the go. It was time to eat. I said, baby, grandma, Danny, cause they can't be beat. She got something else when it was time to choose. And after just one bite, I got that soggy sandwich blue. Should've known better, only Danny will do. Got that hometown flavor creeping up on you. Yeah, she done me wrong. Didn't get my Danny. I need my ham and cheese.
That's all he wanted, that's all he wanted.
Should've known better, only Danny will do. Got that hometown flavor creeping up on you, yeah.
If your ride is making strange noises, don't wait and make it worse. Come to Action Transmission on Merrill Road. My expert technicians can diagnose the problem and likely fix it fast. Experience the difference at Action Transmission on Merrill Road.
For any urological concerns, let Ackerman Urology be your trusted partner in men's health. With offices from Amelia Island to World Golf Village, they treat bladder conditions, elevated PSAs, and ED. Visit AckermanUrology.com.
Friday on The Frangie Show, tune in for the House Call segment brought to you by Jacksonville Orthopedic Institute Rehab. Join the discussion as a JOI expert tells us about baseball and softball injuries. JOI, where the pros go.
Mia O'Brien.
Fun-loving girl.
Weekdays on XL Primetime.
Likes to laugh, lives to love. No dull moments tolerated.
Mia's quick hits are driven by Arlington Toyota on the video and social channels of 1010XL.
Hi, I'm Sean Monahan from Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach. Since 1977, we've been Jacksonville's family jeweler, where our true specialty is engagement rings and custom jewelry design. And now, buy your diamond engagement ring at Monahan's and get any diamond wedding band and men's wedding bands for 50% off. Come in and be treated like family for one of the most important purchases of your life. Buy your diamond engagement ring right now at Monahan's and get any diamond wedding band and gents band for 50% off. Come to Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach or book an appointment at monahanjewelry.com.
Visionaries, builders, and doers, are you ready to change the world? Miller Electric is your opportunity to shape the future. Miller Electric is leading the charge in electric vehicle technology with our state-of-the-art EV Innovation Design Center. We're working to create a sustainable future. We're also the proud partners of the Jacksonville Jaguars, powering their performance at the brand new Miller Electric Center. Miller Electric, we provide competitive pay, unbeatable benefits. Apply today. MillerCareers.com, Miller Electric, an equal opportunity employer.
Ever wonder how you can transform your living spaces into captivating works of art? At First Coast Lighting and Fans, they offer a huge selection of high-quality products to match your desire for elegance, quality, and uniqueness. Visit their showroom on Phillips Highway at the Avenues and step into a world of quality without compromise. Discover the difference that locally owned expertise makes and let them help you experience the transformation from average to extraordinary. At First Coast Lighting and Fans.
Hello, First Coast. I'm sure by now you have seen our bright green GFL trucks and containers throughout the greater Jacksonville area. We're an industry leader in solid waste and would love the opportunity to earn your business. We're committed to customer service, reliability, and have an unwavering focus on safety. Whether commercial or construction, let us haul your waste away. Call 904-760-5880 to get a quote today from GFL, Green for Life.
Hey sports fans, it's Ace Carlion for Kingfish Pest Control. Are mosquitoes turning your outdoor fun into a full contact sport? Time to call in Kingfish Pest Control. I can tell you from my own experience, they are the MVPs of mosquito elimination. See for yourself. Call Kingfish Pest Control today and get an unbeatable 50% off your first treatment. That's right. Sign up for a full season of lockdown coverage and get 50% off your first treatment. Don't let mosquitoes steal your home field advantage. Reclaim your yard with Kingfish Pest Control.
Let's go! Don't miss the Jacksonville Sharks' first home game against the IFL defending champion Bay Area Panthers next Saturday, April 6th, at the Vistar Veterans Memorial Arena, kickoff 7 p.m. Let's go! Let's show them what we got.
Let's go!
Tickets as low as $15. You can't find Saturday family affordable fun anywhere else. Call 904-621-0700 or go to jacksharks.com. Dust off your boots, grab your cowboy hat for Western night. Join us at 5 p.m. for Shark Fest, every home game located outside the arena for our pregame party. Help us rock the tank as we roll out the 2023 NAL Championship.
Let's go!
Don't miss opening night of the season next Saturday, April 6th, 7 o'clock in the Vistar Veterans Memorial Arena. Be a part of indoor football fun and exciting non-stop action. For tickets as low as $15, call 904-621-0700. Don't forget your cowboy hats.
Let's go!
For lost or broken keys or nearly any make and model of vehicle, call 722-1111 for
Instant Keys.
Instant Keys.
You don't have to go to the dealer. Instant Keys comes to you.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. This is Jaguars Today on 1010XL.
I believe so. I believe you can definitely get comfortable. You can kind of believe and read into the hype that's surrounding your football team. And, you know, that's the one thing that you can't happen, right? You got to guard against that, obviously. And you know, that's something that I think our team is going to realize, you know, moving forward.
It's a lot of what we've been talking about in the last 20-something minutes or so. You know, mm-hmm. These veteran additions and not letting that slide into mediocrity happen if at all you can help it. And, you know, look, I don't think this is anything. We're not surprised to hear this now. Jags read their press clippings a little bit last year, right, and got a little bit full of themselves, maybe. Was it the only thing that caused the slide? No. But was it a contributing factor at various times in the season? Yeah, I think it was. I mean, I think that's pretty clear at this point in time.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
You know, look, by the way, Doug Peterson, we played about half of what Doug Peterson had to say.
Right.
There's so much more to get to. A lot of stuff on specific players, a lot of stuff on the wide receiver room, and on and on. And guess what? We got 2 more hours tomorrow. We'll get into a lot of that Doug Peterson audio. You may hear some of that this afternoon on XL Primetime and the Frangie Show, so definitely stick around for those guys. And, you know, the owner's meeting is going on. That means rule changes are taking place, Tony. They did ban the hip drop tackle, but other news around the National Football League, including that, let's take a quick tour.
Now, gems around the NFL. Brought to you by Beaches Jewelry and Pawn in Jacks Beach.
Late on Friday night, after obviously we were done for the week, the Kansas City Chiefs agreed to a trade with the Tennessee Titans that will be sending cornerback Lajarius Sneed to Tennessee, along with a 7th-round pick in exchange for the Titans' 7th-round pick and a 2025 3rd-round draft pick. The Titans are also signing a deal that will put Sneed among the handful of the top-paid corners in the National Football League. Philadelphia signed quarterback Will Greer over the weekend. Greer will join starting quarterback Jalen Hurts and Kenny Pickett, who the Eagles traded for from Pittsburgh, in their quarterback room. New England head coach Gerard Mayo said on Sunday that the Patriots are still open to listening to offers on the number 3 pick in next month's draft, but did add that quarterback is definitely a priority for the team. And as you mentioned, NFL owners have approved a rule proposal to ban the hip drop tackle. The league announced today it will be a 15-yard penalty if flagged in games, going back to something Troy Vincent, the NFL's executive vice president of football operations, said last week. He implied that the rule would likely be enforced in ways similar to that of the use of helmet rule, which typically leads to warning letters and fines during the week following a game rather than by flags during the game. So it'll be interesting to see how the league wants to enforce the hip drop tackle ban going forward. But I was just talking about during the break, they showed the minute that they said, this is why we need to get rid of it. I was like, looks like a bunch of guys tackling guys. Like, how are you supposed to tackle unless you grab the guy and then fall to the ground?
Use your body weight to
Right.
pull him down, right?
Right?
Once you've got him, it's one thing if you've got momentum and you're meeting
him
head to head. Right. What if you get him from the side? What if you do chase him down from behind?
Right. Like, what you're supposed to just shove him? Like,
you're supposed to hold him up and hope for your teammates to come help you.
That's crazy.
That's pretty much it.
That's crazy. We'll
Logically.
See how it works out.
Yeah, exactly. Right. We don't, the law of unintended consequences could come into play. Who knows what the repercussions will be, but it's just something that every team's going to have to deal with. If they do penalize it, like if they go the route where they're fining guys later, I don't think anyone's going to care, quite frankly. Because do you really care who gets penalized, what amount of money? You know, I don't.
The guy getting fined.
He does, right. But the typical person watching it, it doesn't impact our, you know, it's like, oh, it sucks for him that what we thought was a borderline call is going to cost him $35,000 or whatever the case may be. But in the end, I don't think we
if that's the way they enforce it,
yeah, if that's the way it goes. Now, if it goes the other way and they're throwing penalty flags, then it's going to screw you at some point. It's also probably going to screw your opponent at some point as well. But all depends on the prism you're watching it from.
Absolutely.
We all know they're only out to get your team, whoever your team happens to be at any given point. All right, Pockets won't fire up that 10-10 take. Oh, no, 10-10 take. That's right. I'll make this the 10-10 take. How about that? We're doing it anyway. I was so excited about the 10-10 take right here. Today's question of the day, Tony. I think there are several good options for me on this one. So we asked today, the major moves in free agency are likely done. So what do you think is currently the strongest position group on the Jaguars? All right. At the risk of stealing your thunder here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm going to throw a few that I considered into the conversation. I think quarterback is under consideration.
Sure.
Like Trevor Lawrence is the most valuable, the most important player. I don't think he's the best player on this team right now, but I think he's the most important. You did upgrade the room with Mac Jones, so you got 2 first-round picks now at the top of your depth chart, and C.J. Beathard was good enough to win a game for you last year, so I get it if you're going that route. And and you feel that Trevor especially makes that the best. I think offensive tackle, it's got to be in the conversation, right? You got Cam Robinson, Anton Harrison, and Walker Little. You got three guys capable of playing NFL-level tackle right now. If any of them had to play, you don't go, oh, my God, what's going to happen today, mm-hmm. right? So at the moment, I think tackle is pretty strong. I think wide receiver is pretty good. Could be better. I don't put it at the top. To me, honestly, and I, like while safety is deep, I don't think it. I think it lacks the top end talent to make it the best position group on the team. I think it's edge rusher. I do. I think the best player on the team right now is Josh Allen. I think Trayvon Walker is showing that he's well. Maybe he wasn't in everyone's world the ideal pick for the number one overall pick. He's certainly a first round talent. Right? And he's not a bust at the position. Double-digit sacks. You brought in a little bit of depth there. You got two guys at the top that, granted, they have to stay healthy, but I don't know that many teams that have that guy you're fearing as the third, certainly not the fourth pass rusher. There may be teams with a better third pass rusher, but we're not saying are the Jags the best defensive end team in the league. I do think, and it's crazy because they haven't done much to change the room, but I think – edge rush right now is the thing I feel the most confident in for this football team at the moment. How do you feel?
Who? Edge is interesting because that might have been at towards the top of my list, if not the top of my list, 2 years ago.
Okay.
Right? When they still had Arden Key, you know, and DeJuan Smoot wasn't coming off an Achilles. Like, all these different things. I did look at that group and felt pretty good about it. Even with Trayvon as a rookie, I felt pretty good about it. Now, not as much for me because they're just sitting any depth at the position, but we talked about that throughout the year. If I had to pick one spot, I think I probably would land on offensive tackle as the top of that list because it does feel like they could have an injury there and still be okay, right? If they had an injury at edge, they're done. Right, like if either of those top two guys went out, it'd be like, oh my gosh.
But I agree with that. But I also feel that their my expectations for what they're going to produce are higher than whatever combination of tackles you're going to produce on offense.
No doubt.
Right. So it's yes, the depth is questionable. Although I think Travis Gibson helps.
Right.
But you know, you talked about a couple years ago looking at that group. Well, Josh Allen a couple years ago was like a 7-8 sack guy. Mm-hmm. Now he's a 17 sack guy, and you've seen Trayvon Walker prove that he can be a double-digit sack guy on top of that. Anyway.
I would give a shout-out. I think they're really strong with ETN at running back. And I think if ETN went down, I'd be okay.
Yeah.
I do.
I think they're okay.
I think the combination of those two guys, if they had to carry it for a couple weeks while ETN was out, I think they'd be fine at running back, given the nature of that position. I'd be tempted to list tight end there too because they did invest a second-round pick in Strange. He didn't do anything yet, but they invested that second-round pick in him. I'm not saying that he can replace Ingram, but those are positions that I don't think you need real crazy depth to feel okay about the position for you.
Yeah, I wouldn't feel good about it if either one of those frontline guys. Now, granted, same thing at defensive end, but – and I think, again, the frontline play there at edge puts him at the top. For me, got a lot of mentions of the defensive line as a whole, a lot of mentions of quarterback,
mm-hmm.
Some mention of offensive tackle, wide receiver. So a smattering DBs in general. Again, safety probably the deepest position on the team. That doesn't mean it's the best position on the team
sure.
necessarily. You've got a lot of at least league average guys that could play in that spot where you don't have that kind of depth at some of the other spots, understandably so. All right, let's wrap that up and welcome in XL Primetime. Joe C. in the house. So hello, Joseph. How are you?
Hello, hello, hello.
What you guys got cooking today, huh?
We're definitely going to be talking about what Doug had to say at the owner's meeting.
Had a lot to say, huh?
Yeah, he
thought
really
for
did.
For a long time today.
Look, dude, I listened and watched on Jaguars.com, and then when whoever, Gibby, I think, cut it up, it was close to 40 cuts.
Yeah, that's a bunch. Yeah.
And so the one that obviously stuck out to me is that it's that, quote, bad taste in his mouth, how everything just completely unraveled after the 8-3 record going into December. And I don't blame him. He should be ticked off about that. And then also Nielsen predominantly will look at a four-man front. I like that. And then the changes that they've made, sending guys off, bringing guys in. So we'll get into all that stuff. And then, of course, the March Madness, the brackets. March Sadness, March Madness.
I would have been looking. I would have been looking pretty good, actually. Even losing Kentucky, I would have been looking good if Texas A&M had won that in overtime, because I had them beating Houston in that game. And when he knocked down that three, I was like, "Oh, this is gonna be nice." I'm telling you, Heather's bracket is strong.
Is it,
bro? Yeah. She got her whole Final Four. She's got NC State in the Elite Eight. And didn't go crazy with any other upsets, and this is the year to do that, you know?
So. Yeah, and I kind of, like, had the upsets to begin with and then just kind of leveled out. I got NC State going deep enough. I don't have them in the Final Four, I don't believe. No, I don't. But Houston had me worried yesterday, of course, you know, and UConn's chalk.
Sure. But, you know, and that's what it is. So how many you got left?
I haven't even looked, to be honest with you, but
I'm going to say not enough.
Yeah.
If that's the case. I feel like if we know we got a shot,
no.
We know.
You want to know what? I'm more upset about my points decision yesterday. That's what got me more than anything else, because I have Houston, Arizona, UConn, and I can't remember who the fourth one is.
Creighton.
It might be.
Creighton.
Yeah, it might be.
Yeah.
It might be. Anyway, so I don't have anybody higher than a three making it to the Final Four.
Right.
But I did have NC State, you know, making it this far and go. I think I've got them going into the eight.
Nice. All right. Well, Joe, have a great show. A lot
right,
to
fellas.
Dig into today. Plenty new on the Jaguar front, which we always appreciate around these parts. Thanks to Mike DiRocco for joining us. We're going to be efforting Chad Ryder tomorrow from NFL.com. We good with him?
We got him 10:40.
10:40 tomorrow. Talk about his new four-round mock. We didn't even scratch the surface on that one today, so we'll get into that tomorrow. More from Doug Peterson as well, because, again, we get maybe halfway through the log pile today, yeah. Tony, on everything he had to say, and that's just fine at this time of year. Got plenty of time. Pockets, just about a month out now, baby.
Yeah.
Is that media mock draft time?
Oh, yeah.
What are we on, Tony? You're 21?
That's a hacker question.
I don't.
I'll follow up with you.
One year we would figure out just this is the year it started. It's over 20 now that we've done the media mock draft. So we'll knock that bad boy out in a few weeks as well. All right, that'll do it for us today. Everybody have a great day out there. For Tony Smith, Dylan Denmark, and again, Mike DiRocco, I'm Mike Dempsey. Thank you for listening to Jaguars today. Please do stick around for XL Primetime straight ahead on 1010XL 92.5 FM.
Jaguars today. From